So now let us study what are known as standards and codes. So let us assume at our home we have a plug and socket arrangement. Let us say there is a socket here, there is a socket, you have got three holes there, okay, and then there is a plug and plug has got three pins. Imagine this plug is not working, there is some disconnection or some part is broken. So immediately what we do is we go to the shop and replace this one and get a new one. The new plug will easily fit into the old socket. So how is that the guy in the electric shop knows the size of the sockets at your home? It is because the both manufacturers, irrespective of the company, will always follow certain standards. That means they say the plug should always be of particular diameter, particular size, and so that any company's plug will fit into the socket of the any company. So that way it is very easy for customers to use it. Let's come back to the more formal definition of standards. So standard is set up specifications for parts, also materials, and also for processes. So basically it is a document. A standard is nothing but a document and reference material used by both engineers, manufacturers, as well as users. So what do they contain? They contain technical definitions. They first define, for example, in our case, they'll define what is a socket, they'll define what is a plug, and then they'll say procedures and guidelines for their manufacturers. Now they'll specify the dimensions, like what is the minimum size. For example, in India, what should be the size of a plug, what should be the size of a socket is clearly mentioned in these guidelines. And also the minimum, for example, if it is a electrical equipment, they will also say minimum requirements. That means you should have a material such that you don't get electrical shock. So all these conditions are mentioned for a manufacturer. So you can't manufacture a plug made of iron. Okay, so this will violate the safety norms. So therefore, many such. One is the basic definitions and dimensions. Second one is minimum requirement. The safety requirements and the other requirements are mentioned in these documents. So it may contain a particular shape of the component, how to test a particular component. For example, you want to say a waterproof socket. So how do you do it? How to test it, whether it is waterproof or not? And there is also possibility of marking on it. Somebody says it's a 5 ampere plug or somebody says it's 15 ampere plug. You want to write it over there so that users can easily differentiate. So where exactly you have to write this? All those things are specified in this document. Okay. So that is an advantage of having a standard. Standard is basically is a set of specifications, conditions. Okay. For parts, materials, and process. Not only for a component, even it is for example, you want to test a steel specimen. For that also, we have certain standards. What should be the dimension of the specimen, how to hold them, and what load to be applied. All those things are mentioned in the standards. Now, who creates them? Basically, these are created by two set of people. One is experienced engineering societies. Engineering societies are nothing but Association of engineers, senior and experienced engineers. They will release the guidelines saying that based on their experiences, they'll define the dimensions and the procedures to be followed. Or it could be a government agencies like for example, Bureau of Indian Standard. So it's a government organization. It will tell you what should be the minimum specifications to be followed, minimum size and dimensions to be used in a product. Oh, what is the purpose of having a common document for all the peoples, right from users to the manufacturer to the engineers? It has its own advantage. What are the advantages? First thing, for user perspective, it is easily available. Example, my plug has gone. So I can simply go to the nearby shop and purchase my plug. So there is easy availability because all the companies and all the manufacturers will follow the same dimension. So I don't have an issue. You can just go and replace the part. So that there is a quick replacement, and for me, I don't have to throw the entire electrical device. Just a plug has gone, so I'll replace the plug. That way, I got low maintenance cost. And what happens, what is the advantage for manufacturers? For manufacturers, allows for specialization. So if somebody's a machine may contain hundreds of parts, but one may not be specialist in all 100 parts. So what they'll do is they will only take certain parts of this machine and then become specialist in that. So remaining parts that are required, they will purchase from other manufacturers. So that way, you can specialize in very few set of components and you can achieve good quality in them. And what is the advantage from the retailers? Advantage for the retailers who sell those items. So they don't have to keep the stock of many varieties. So because, for example, a plug may have it in only three varieties. Okay, so they can easily take stock of these three varieties. Otherwise, if everybody starts making their own plugs without any standard, they may have to keep hundreds of varieties in their shop, and not all hundreds may be sold. So that is a burden for them and a loss to the retailer. So that's why lesser the varieties, better for the retailers also. Now we'll see different categories of standards. These standards can be of three types. The first one, or rather they are categories basically. The first one is a company standards. These are the standard reference documents used within the company. For example, Apple company may use its own standards, which is valid for all the departments in it. However, this will not be technically a standard because this may not be valid beyond the company. So therefore, it's simply called a in-house standard. Then we have national standards provided by the governments of each country. For example, IS is a standard, Bureau of Indian Standards, and for example, DIN is a standard of Germany, and Society of Automotive Engineers is a standard of USA. Similarly, each country can have its own standard. So these standards are valid throughout that country. And then we have third one, the International Standard Organizations. So these standards are valid so across the globe. So most companies follow this ISO standards, and sometimes certain standards like SAE standards, though it is an American standard, because of its popularity, it may be used by all other countries also. So thus we have three categories of standards. So now let us see what are the different types of standards used in mechanical engineering in particular. The first one is standards which are exclusively for materials, that is, and their compositions. Okay, so we want to name certain materials based on their compositions and based on their heat treatments. Okay, so for example, we have IS 210. Okay, this standard specifies different grades of gray cast irons. Okay, for example, it is named as FG. So FG basically means it's a iron with 220 number, indicates it's certain specifications mentioned in the document IS 210. Similarly, we have IS 1570, which contains the specification for chemical compositions of various alloy steels. So if somebody wants to prepare a material, so he has to follow this particular standard. So this is first one, that is standards for materials and their compositions. Then we have second one, standard for shapes and dimensions for commonly used machine elements. For example, it could be a shaft or it could be a V-welds. So somebody wants to purchase or a manufacturer, he has to follow these standards. For example, IS 2494 specifies the dimensions and shape of the cross section of endless V belts for power transmissions. So manufacturer has to follow this cross sections mentioned in this document and also use the dimensions mentioned in the document so that others can easily buy from them. Similarly, we have IS 5129 for rotor shaft aisle seal units. So that is about the shapes and dimensions. The third one is for fits, tolerance and surface finish of the components. The tolerance or upper and lower limits for various sizes of holes and shafts are specified in IS 919. Similarly, if you want to indicate the surface texture, you can follow IS 10719 on technical drawings. The next one is a standard for testing of products. So these contain procedure to test the products, such as pressure vessel, boiler, crane, wire rope, etc. For example, we have IS 2825. This particular standard mentions about how to test a pressure vessel. All these conditions to be followed while testing a pressure vessel are explained in this. And the fifth one is standards for engineering drawing of components. Okay, for example, SP46 prepared by Bureau of Indian Standards on engineering drawing practices for schools and colleges will cover all the standards relating to engineering drawing. Now we will see what are known as codes. Codes are similar to standards, except that codes have got some legal connotation to them. That means there is a legal provision involved in code compared to standards. By definition, code is specification for the analysis, design, manufacture and construction of something. The purpose of the code is to achieve specified degree of safety, efficiency and performance or quality. So that is again mentioned in this. One important aspect of code as against standard is this is legally binding on the person who uses this code. For example, if you are constructing a house, you need to follow a construction code. For example, if the building fails, then legally you are safe. If you have not followed the construction code and still the building fails, then you are legally prosecuted and you may be put behind the bars. So therefore, we say this is legally binding document. Non-compliance will result being prosecuted. So one should be careful. For example, if you are manufacturing a pressure vessel, you should follow the pressure vessel manufacturing code. And this can be created by industry, government or voluntary organizations. And code sometimes may also include a reference to the standards. So standard plus something will become code. In that way, code is a superset of the standard. Standard plus something, first law, then will become a code. Now let us study the concept of preferred sizes or preferred numbers. This is a part of the standardization. Suppose consider I am a shaft manufacturer and I want to produce 5 different sizes of shafts from 10 mm diameter to 100 mm diameter. Okay, now so what are the chances? How should I distribute these 5 sizes? So one way is I can choose 10 mm, 11 mm, 12 mm, 13 and 100. So if I do like this, then most of my diameters are close to 10. Only when somebody wants a smaller diameter, these things will be useful. But if somebody wants a bigger diameter, he cannot choose from this list. Another way is I may choose to have say 95, 96, 97, 98 and 100. So again, this is biased towards higher sizes. So both are wrong. So ideally, I should have diameters spread over complete span. Say I may choose 10, 20, 35, 50, 75, 100 like this. So that people can choose, even people looking for a smaller diameter can choose from this. And people looking for a higher diameter can choose from this. So, but the problem again here is exactly whether to take 20 or 21 is a problem. So, ideally, what should I do is I should go to a standard, that is standards and codes which are relevant to the shaft diameters, and then choose the diameter size from this list. Now, the question is, how do these guys, the standardization guys, determine the numbers between 10 to 100 as a standard numbers? So then we'll use a concept called as preferred sizes. As the name indicates, certain numbers are preferred or given importance compared to other numbers. Therefore, we use the word preferred sizes or preferred numbers. The concept of preferred numbers was provided by Charles Renard in early 1870s. Renard numbers provide a ratio between consecutive sizes that can be used to create certain number of sizes within a decade. So what does it mean? It means Reynolds numbers will help us to generate some numbers between 1 to 10 which are of preferential nature. So when I say size, please remember size, it could mean diameter, it could mean load carrying capacity, or it could mean dimension of a particular component. Okay, so coming back, Reynolds number gives us some preferential numbers between 1 to 10. Once we know the numbers between 1 to 10, that can be extended beyond 10 and below 1 also. So those methods will also be discussed here. Now, the same concept of Reynolds numbers has been used in ISO standards. So if you want to generate numbers between, say, 1 to 10, okay, so I want 5 numbers, then what are the numbers should I prefer? Similarly, if I want numbers between 1 to 10, around I want some 10 numbers. So then what are the numbers to be used? All these things are defined in ISO standards, and there are series. So those, there are 4 basic series named as R5, R10, R20 and R40. And an additional exceptional series called R80. Let's understand what are these series are. Series, of course, we know, it's just a series of numbers. Let me say I got a series like 2, 4, 6, 8. So this, it keeps on going like this. So these series are nothing but geometric series. That means the ratio of xn plus 1 by xn is equal to constant. For example, if I take a number, let us say 2, I may take 4, 8, 16. This is a series with a constant geometric ratio. Geometric ratio means the next number divided by the first number. So let us say we have got 4 by 2. It gives me the value as 2. So ratio of the second number divided by the first number. Similarly, if I go to 8 by 4. So 8 by 4, this is again 2. Similarly, if I go to 16 by 8, 16 by 8 is again 2. So this ratio is called geometric ratio, which is constant. Similarly, these series, the Reynolds series, have a constant geometric ratio given by this table. The first series, named as R5 series, has got a geometric ratio of 1.58. If you take the fifth root of 10, you will get this 1 point something. But actually speaking, you will get a bigger number, and which is shortened. If I take a fifth, that is, if I take the this particular root, let's say this 10 root of 10 is 1 point, it's actually 1.2589, something like this, which is rounded up to 1.26. So we have got the geometric ratio obtained by this formula. So R5 series has a geometric ratio of 1.58, R10 series has a geometric ratio of 1.26, R20 series has a geometric ratio of 1.12, and similarly R40 has got 1.06 and R80 has got 1.03. So what is the meaning of this geometric ratio? Geometric ratio is used to generate the number in the series. For example, how to generate the R5 series, we will see an example. Now, as per our formula, R5 series has got a geometric ratio of 1.58. Okay, this is geometric ratio for the R5 series. Now, how to generate? First number, let me be 1. Second number is obtained by multiplying 1.58 to this number. So we'll get 1 into 1.58. So third number is obtained by once again multiplying it to 1 into 1.58 into 1.58. Fourth number is once again obtained as 1 into 1.58 three times. So like this, you can generate all the numbers in between. So we have given example. We have taken the 1, first you multiply with geometric series once, multiply with geometric series twice, thrice and four times, you will get the corresponding number. So I will get first 1, 1.58, 2.49, 3.9, 6.2 and 9.8. Now these are rounded up to the nearest number. So 1 and this becomes 1.6, this becomes 2.5, 4, 6.3 and 10. So now we can think R5 as, because the number is 5, we'll say it is a series which has got 5 values between 1 to 10, including 1 or excluding 10. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 values between 1 to 10. So these are the preferred numbers. It means what? If somebody wants to generate a shaft or manufacture a shaft of size 1 mm to 10 mm. You want to have 5 different sizes, then you should choose either 1, 1.6, 2.5, 4, 6.3 or 10. So this is the advantage of having Reynolds numbers. These Reynolds numbers or the R5 series can be extended both in upward direction as well as in back downward direction. For example, the original series is 1 to 10 like this. Okay, so you can extend, you can get the next number by multiplying this number with 1.58. So 10 into 1.58, you will get 15.8, which is rounded off to 16. Again, this 16 you multiply with 1.58. This is geometric series of this geometric ratio of this series. You will get around 25. So this is, you can increase the series by multiplying with the geometric number. Similarly, you can decrease the series by dividing with the geometric ratio. So 1 by 1.58. So if you want to get this number, so you have to divide 1 by 1.58, you will get this number. Similarly, you divide once again by 1.58, you will get 0.4. So like this, you can keep on expanding the series in either direction. So you can go downwards or you can go upwards. So basic series are provided in the standards are 1 to 10 and can be increased or it can be decreased. So this is about R5 series. So in the similar fashions, we have what is known as R10 series. R10 series, as the name indicates, these are the series or the numbers between 1 to 10 and it has got 10 values in between. So therefore the word R10 series. Okay. For example, if the values are 20, we'll say R20 series. So only difference is the geometric ratio for this series is 1.26. That means what? If take 1, actually speaking, it is 1.25 something, but it is rounded up to 1.26. So first number is 1 and multiply with the geometric series, you will get 1.25 and again multiply with 1.26 once again, you will get this number. Again multiply with this geometric geometric ratio, you will get this number. Similarly, you can generate all the numbers. So these have been recorded in a standard. One can refer the standard and get these numbers. So similarly, that is R10 series. So when we expand R10 series, we get the numbers as shown earlier. So we can also generate R20 numbers. R20 basically means the numbers between 1 to 10 and total there are 20 values in between. So the minimum and maximum given in the standard is 1 to 10 only. So if you have 20 numbers in between, we call it as R20 series. If you have got 40 numbers, for example, look at the R40 series. So minimum is still 1 only, maximum is still 10 only. So in between, we have total 40 numbers in this. So that's why it's called R40 series. So let me summarize. We have got R5 series, R10 series, R20 series and R40 series. So these are the basic series defined in the standard. So I have shown a diagram which is taken from Wikipedia, which gives you the various numbers under R5, R10, R20 and R40 series, and we also see what is it R80 series also. You can see. Before we proceed to derived series, we'll also see what is it R80 series. R80 series is just like another series, except that the geometric ratio is 1.03. We have got 80 values between 1 to 10. So the naming exception series is, they should be avoided. The first preference should be given to R5, if not R10, if not R20, if not R40. So in that order, you should choose. In the very rare exceptional circumstances, you should go for R80 series. That was the meaning of this. Then we will go to second part called derived series. So what are derived series? These are the series that are formed on the basis of 5 basic series. That is whatever we have seen already. Based on that, we can derive. So how do you derive? There are two ways to derive series from this. One is, so you can expand the series, let's say R5 series. You can increase the series or you can decrease the series. Increase basically means you can add some numbers, additional numbers in the series, or you can remove certain numbers and get a series. So let us see how to do that. The first one, let us say how to get the series by reducing the numbers of a particular basic series. let me take an example of R10 series. So how to reduce the series? By removing certain number. So these numbers cannot be removed randomly. Certain rule has to be followed. For example, I want to take only the every second number or every third number, or in general I can say every nth number. So let us make it clear by an example here. So somebody, if I write something like that, if I say R10, it means R10 series. If I write R10 bar 3, okay, let me write here itself, R10 bar 3, in the bracket I write 1 comma dot dot 1000. So it's the meaning of this. Basically it says it's R10 series, and this number 3 indicates every third number, okay, and in the bracket the first number indicates its minimum value is 1 and a maximum value is 1000. Let us go into detail now. So R10 series, we know up to this point we know 1 to 10, which is already given in the standard. Now we want to take only the third number, every third number. Okay, so this is 0, 1, 2, 3. So this will be the third number. Again, 1, 2, 3. This will be the third number. So I'll take 1, 2, 3. So like this. 8. So basically what I mean by this is, I'll take first number and then next third number and next third number and remove the other numbers in between. So that is the meaning of this number 3 here. Okay. Now here again we have got the maximum value as 1000. That means you can expand this further. You know how to expand the series, we already discussed. You simply multiply with the geometric ratio of this particular R10. As you know, R10 has got a geometric ratio that you have discussed here. R10 has got a geometric ratio of 1.2589 or 1.26. So after 10 here, if you multiply with 1.25, you will get 12.5. Like that, you can keep on expanding the series until you get the maximum value of 1000. Let me repeat. So the meaning of this R10 bar 3 is, the first notation R10 indicates this is basically an R10 series. And this bar 3 indicates I am only taking the every third number in the series. And in the bracket, if I write the first number, it is a minimum value. If I write the last value, that is a maximum value. So that's what we get. Finally, the answer for this is 1, 2, 4, 8. Remember, the 1.25, 1.6 other numbers have been removed. Only I am using the first number, next third number, and next third number, and so on. So that's the meaning of R10 bar 3 with a bracket 1 and 1000. Now similarly, what is the meaning of this? Let's look at this second example. We have got R10 bar 3, a bracket shown like this. So here we are not given any minimum value is not mentioned, maximum value is not mentioned. Instead, dots are mentioned. So what is the meaning of this? Let's come back to the beginning. So it says R10. R10 means it's the R10 series numbers. And I am writing this 3. 3 indicates every third number is to be taken. And the meaning of this particular bracket is, the series should have a number 80. The minimum value can be anything. Maximum value can be anything. That means it's basically an infinite series. Except that we have a guaranteed 80 number in the series. So it is unlimited in both the direction, and including the term 80. Similarly, look at this example, R20 bar 4 bracket 112. So here I've written the minimum value. The first value is written, whereas the maximum value is not written. That means there is no maximum value. It can run till infinity. So this is a R20 series, and I'm interested in every fourth number. Okay. And the minimum should be 112, and maximum can be anything. So that means what? It's a R20 series, every fourth term, and limited in lower direction to 112. So you cannot go beyond 112, but maximum can be anything. So in the similar fashion, I'll write R40 bar 5 dot dot 60. So here I'm not mentioning the minimum value, only I'm mentioning the maximum value. So this means this is R40 series. I'm interested in the fifth value, every fifth alternate fifth value. And then there is no minimum value. It can be any value we want. The maximum must be limited to 60. So that is the meaning of this particular series. So all these series we obtained by removing certain numbers in the original series. Okay. So that's why we say the derived series obtained so far are by removing the numbers. Okay, now let us see how can we increase the numbers in the series. So that is the second method. So increasing the numbers in the basic series. Okay, let's consider an example. The basic series R5 is known here, that is 1 to 10. We have got 5 values in between. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or you can say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You can exclude 10 also. Now the next numbers are obtained. Okay, the series next numbers obtained by multiplying the above numbers by 10. So we get the numbers. So 1.6 multiplied with 10, 16. 2.5 multiplied with 10, we get 25, 40, 63, and 100 in this fashion. So if you want even bigger numbers, you can still multiply with 10 to the present series. So this again, 16 is multiplied with 10, 160, 250, 400, 63,000. Like this, you can go on increasing the series as you want. So this is generating the derived series from the basic series by increasing the numbers. And we can also combine the values that we have got here, so this one, and this 3, and we finally get a very big series which contains the numbers from 1 to 10 that are basically nothing but R5 series.